assured of the forgiveness made available to us through Christ. But before we dive into this text, and before I start this sermon, I think I need to confess before all of you that I love to watch The Real Housewives. I could spend hours sitting on my couch watching the housewives do their thing, and by I could spend hours, I mean I do spend hours. And while we're on the topic of my embarrassing television habits, I should probably also put out there that I love romantic comedies. And you might be thinking that that doesn't really merit confession, and you'd be right if you're thinking of the good romantic comedies, when Harry Met Sally, Love Actually, those sorts of movies. I love those. But also, what really merits confession is that I love the bad romantic comedies. And I'm talking about made-for-TV, only airs on ABC Family, sort of romantic comedies. If there's a movie on that seems likely to end in a wedding scene while the credits roll, I hate it. I want to watch it. I think these confessions need to be shared this morning because we're in the midst of the story of Jacob. And Jacob is that patriarch of our faith who has a life written out in Genesis. We know a lot about his life. He's the last name on that famous description of God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He's a man whose name is eventually changed to Israel, which comes to mean all of God's people throughout Scripture. And you might have noticed in the reading this morning, or from some of the other stories of Jacob that we've considered over the past few weeks, that his life is a lot like The Real Housewives. And today's text is a lot like those bad romantic comedies that I love. Our reading this morning picked up in the middle of the story, which means that we miss the meet cute. Now, for those of you who aren't fully fluent in rom-com lingo, rom-com is short for romantic comedies, the meet cute, well, let me read to you the definition provided by that always reliable source, Wikipedia. A meet cute is a scene in film, television, etc., in which a future romantic couple meets for the first time in a way that is considered adorable, entertaining, or amusing. Meet cutes commonly involve contrived, unusual, or comic circumstances. Frequently, the meet cute leads to a humorous clash of personalities or beliefs, embarrassing situations, or comical misunderstandings that further drive the plot. A great example that you might have seen comes from The Wedding Planner. A woman is walking down the street and her high heels shoe gets stuck in a grave because a dumpster is set loose and is rolling down a hill towards her, but don't worry, Matthew McConaughey is right there to sweep her off her feet and save the day. She faints in his arms. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. Jacob has a meet-cute with Rachel, and it happens in the passage just before ours. But before we get there, I think it makes sense to do a quick recap of Jacob's life so far. And you should buckle your seatbelts because a lot happens in Jacob's life. You'll remember from 2 weeks ago when Aida preached the story of Jacob's birth. Jacob has a twin brother named Esau, and their mother, Rebecca, says that they are fighting one another in the womb from day one. I talk about sibling rivalry. In fact, it's so bad that Rebecca says, if it is to be this way, why do I live? Which doesn't sound like a pleasant pregnancy. When they're born, Esau is born first. He's the older brother. But Jacob comes out holding onto his heel, already jealous of his older brother's status. He's determined to get what he can from day one. And then one day when they're older, Esau comes home from a day of work in the field, and he is hungry. And so Jacob seizes the opportunity to sell Esau some food for the low, low price of his birthright as oldest son. Because Esau, though bigger and stronger, is not wiser than Jacob, he sells his birthright for a meal. And then, of course, Rebecca schemes with Jacob, her favorite son, to steal Isaac, his father's blessing. They dress Jacob up in goat skin so that he will feel hairy like his brother. He wears Esau's clothes so he will smell right because Isaac does not see very well. And Jacob steals his father's blessing. And Esau, this time, knows what he has lost and is full of murderous rage. He declares that after his father dies, he's going to kill his brother Jacob. And so Jacob flees to Haran, where his mother's brother Laban lives. And remember from last week that on the way, Jacob has a pretty incredible dream. He lays down with a rock for a pillow, and he sees a ladder that connects heaven and earth, with angels going up and down. And he is amazed, and then realizes that the Lord God is next to him, and God says, "Know that I am with you, and will keep you wherever you go." and I will not leave you until I have done what I promised. So Jacob wakes up and anoints the place and calls it Bethel, house of God. And then, because he's still a schemer, Jacob declares that if God keeps this promise, then he'll give 10% back, which is a pretty good deal. God has promised Jacob a lot of things. And so now we are almost caught up to our text this morning, and here comes the meet cute. Jacob leaves Bethel and comes to a well in the middle of the field, and there are shepherds standing around, but they're not opening the well, because it's only fair if they wait for every shepherd to arrive so that they can all get an equal share of the water. But then he sees a beautiful woman, Rachel, coming with her father's sheep, and he's so moved by her beauty that he rolls the stone away from the well by himself. He's very strong, and waters her sheep. There is weeping and kissing. She takes him home to meet her father, Laban. There's more weeping and kissing and embracing. It's a classic meet-cute. It's adorable. It's entertaining. It seems like they are destined to be together forever. It's a wonderful love story. So Laban asks Jacob, well, if you're going to work for me, what can I pay you? And Jacob says, I will take her, Rachel. And Laban says, great, the price for one daughter is 7 years of labor, and she's all yours, and they agree to this deal. And so Jacob works for 7 years, and it feels like not a day, maybe just a few days. But as with all romantic comedies, we know it can't be quite that simple, right? No way do they just meet, fall in love, get married, and live happily ever after. There's always something else that gets in the way. And in this story, that something else is named Laban. The 7 years are up, and Jacob has worked for Rachel, and so Laban throws a wedding banquet, presumably with lots of wine, so that when Jacob is in the honeymoon suite, Laban is able to send in not his daughter Rachel, as he had promised, but Leah, with a veil over her face. For whatever reason, Jacob doesn't notice. And in the morning, he realizes that it was Leah, and he's mad, which I think is fair. This was not the agreement, and he has just consummated his marriage with the wrong woman. So he goes to Laban, presumably pretty outraged, to find out why he has been deceived. And Laban gives a simple answer. Well, it's not our custom around here to marry off the younger daughter before the older one, so I guess you gotta have the older one. But Laban is still willing to let Jacob marry Rachel. He just needs to complete the marriage feat with Leah and then work 7 more years. And Genesis tells us Jacob did so and completed her week. Then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel as a wife. So Jacob went into Rachel also, and he loved Rachel more than Leah. He served Laban for another 7 years. Roll credits, our romantic comedy has come to a close. But I can't help but wonder how Jacob really felt about this arrangement, this 7 more years of work. The first time around, we're told that he so loved Rachel that the 7 years flew by in a flash. But this second 7 years, all we know is Jacob did so. I wonder if he recognized the parallels between his own trickery, stealing the blessing from his older brother, and then being tricked into marrying an older daughter. I wonder if he was able to say, well played, Uncle Laban, if he admired Laban's scheming, saw something of himself in his uncle. I wonder if he was mad that he had the wool pulled over his eyes, if he was angry that he'd been duped. We don't know what Jacob's reaction was, really, but we do know that he put in the second 7 years. And I think it's safe to say that they probably felt like more than just a few days. The last verse in our reading this morning says, Jacob loved Rachel more than Leah. And there is a lot of foreshadowing in that line. I think Jacob and Esau had a sibling rivalry going, wait until you read about Rachel and Leah. They share a husband, and they're both desperate to bear sons, though Leah has 4 sons back-to-back before Rachel gets pregnant once. Forget the Real Housewives of Orange County, the Real Housewives of Harad, because they ripping Harad. Watching television this week, just read some Genesis. You can't make this stuff up. So, I'm sure that those 7 years felt long. They're full of sibling rivalry and plenty of family tension. I'm sure they felt long for Jacob and for Rachel and for Leah. I'm sure they felt long. Last week, Trey reminded us of the importance of the the place Jacob calls Bethel, the place where he had his dream, where he sees the ladder connecting heaven and earth. The place where God speaks to Jacob and says, "Know that I am with you and will keep you wherever you go. I will not leave you until I have done what I promised." And Jacob wakes up from that dream and he says, "Surely God was in this place and I did not even know it." Troy reminded us last week that Jacob will ultimately return to Bethel years later, where he will be reminded of God's promise to be with him and to keep him, even when God was with him and he didn't know it. But our reading this morning, this story of how Jacob comes to be married to both Rachel and Leah, this story of Laban's trickery, this story that lasts 14 years, there's no mention of God in this story. I find myself wondering, God has just promised to be with Jacob and to keep him. And then in the next chapter, no mention of what God is up to. And if I'm wondering where God is in this, I bet that Jacob is wondering too. So maybe those first 7 years really did go by in a flash. Jacob was so in love with Rachel, he was so sure that God would fulfill God's promises that he had no doubt that God was with him. Maybe. Or maybe Jacob just didn't think too much about God. He was so smitten with Rachel, he was so far from Bethel, he had left his murderous brother behind, he was busy with work. Maybe he just didn't notice whether or not God was there. Maybe. Or maybe Jacob was angry with God, angry that he had been tricked, angry that he had to put in another 7 years in this place, angry that God's promises were taking so long to be filled. Maybe Jacob was entirely frustrated with God. The truth is, we don't know how Jacob felt during those years, but we do know what it's like to be in the middle, to be between receiving the promise and seeing that the promise has been. We've had moments of clarity where we are sure that there is traffic between heaven and earth, sure that God is with us and will keep us. We've had moments where we were able to say, "Surely God was in this place and I didn't even know it." But so often we walk away from those moments right back into the thick of things. And so we know that it is hard to be in the middle. We felt abandoned by God. We felt angry at the places to which God has brought us. We've just been so busy that we haven't had time to notice what God is up to. We can imagine what Jacob might have felt during those years in the middle. We can imagine because we've been there. I was talking with a friend this week who just started a new job. I was asking him how it was going. He said, "Have you ever been to a lake and you've looked out and the water is clear and beautiful, and if you look down, you can see straight to the bottom. And then you step into the water and immediately things are all mucked up. Suddenly you can't see the bottom. Suddenly it doesn't seem clear. Things are swimming past your legs and you don't know what they are, where they're coming from, or where they're going. As soon as you're in the middle, it seems like that clarity is gone." I think that is exactly what it feels like to be in the middle. Often in the middle, we lose sight of our own toes, not to mention that we lose sight of the God who promised to be with us and keep us. Something that seemed so beautiful and peaceful and serene back when we were receiving the promises is a lot scarier when we are in it. Imagine that that is what Jacob is feeling like in this story with Rachel and Leah. It doesn't really seem like God is that involved. This story seems awfully human, with people scheming to get what they want, and no direct action from the Lord God. But friends, the good news is that God is with us in the middle. God is with us when we can't see our own toes. God is with us when things seem awfully human. When we forget to look for God because things are so good that we think we don't need to, or when things are so bad that we can't imagine that God would ever let this happen, even when it seems that God must be working against us and not for us, even when our love fails, God's love remains steadfast. The God who promises to keep Jacob promises to keep us too. We worship the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. seems impossible. Water is murky, and we can't see our toes, and everything seems too human. God's promise is there. Just as God will bring Jacob back to Bethel to be reminded of the promise, God is bringing us back to a place where we know that God's promises are sure. Then, God is calling us right back out to the middle, back to where things are murky and terrifying and exciting and unknown. God is with us, and God is keeping us, even when we don't know it.